So hello everyone, I will talk about a virtual polymer. So it's an homemade tool, simulation tool, to model the polymer aging. So my name is Morgane Boudin. So I will do a brief introduction. After that, I will talk about the concept of virtual polymer, so don't be worried. I will not go through the line of code, so don't be afraid. And of course, I will illustrate the virtual polymer with some study cases. So let's start with a few figures. So I'm working for EDF, so Electricité de France, which is a French company supplying and producing electricity. I'm working in the research and development center, so close to Paris, close to Fontainebleau. It's the city of the well-known Napoleon Bonaparte. So it's just here on the map, so just to show you. So in France, we have 18 nuclear power plants. And as you could see since the beginning of the week, some figures about the electrical cable. So we have 1,500 kilometers of cables per nuclear unit, including 50 kilometers in the reactor building. And these electrical cables must work, of course, under normal conditions, but also under accidental conditions and post-accident conditions. So it's a question of safety. So that's why we are all here deeply working on the estimation of the duration life, taking into account the environmental factors, so mainly oxygen, but also temperature and radiation, of course. So I will show you or introduce the concept of virtual polymer. So let's talk about specifications. So what is first a virtual polymer? So it's one dimension tool for polymer chemical kinetic modeling. And we develop the software or the numerical tool to capitalize develop models. To be a generic tool, so we do not want a predefined equation in the tool, and to be didactical, so no black box. We need to know, we need to understand, in fact. So we also develop a user guide to learn and to explain the tool. And we want to control the code on its evolution. So that's why we integrate a quality process. For example, to control the evolution, we integrate some non-regression tests. And this numerical tool is written in Python. So free code, in fact. This numerical tool aims to model the degradation. So most of the time you have the initial state, so macroscopic properties, and if you are lucky, you could have H cables, for example, and you could characterize macroscopic property. So virtual polymer aims to bridge these two states, in fact. So from the macroscopic properties to the molecular properties, and from the initial states to the aged states. And it aims to also to have extra bridges, if I could say, in order to have, of course, the bridge between the microstructure and the chemistry, but also the bridge between the local properties and the microstructure. And if you want to add a thickness, of course, sometimes you need to do homogenization. But for that, you need to know some input data. And for example, for virtual polymer, you need to know the chemistry of the polymer, but also the microstructure. So So you need to have some chemical reaction involved in the aging process. So here it's an example of the phagogenesis of Émilie Courvoisier. So that's chemical reactions explained by Xavier, sorry, just before. And you need to know also the differential equation system, so also explained by Xavier. And you need to know the boundary conditions. So as we just said before, so for example, the diffusion, so coefficient diffusion, but also evaporation in sometimes. So now how we can use a virtual polymer. So we define different components. So the first one aims to manage the database to create equations, but also to store equation on model. So for each component, you have an input file and output file. For that, you could solve analytical equations. So for example, the classical one is Arrhenius law. So to determine the kinetics for one equation according to the temperature used. Third one component is a mechanistic component, I call it like that, to solve the stiff equation. As Xavier said, it's not so easy to solve this equation system because you have stiff reaction according to the species investigated. You have the last component to post-treat the output data from the mechanistic components in order to see, for example, to calculate the scission of the cross-linking reaction in your polymer. Okay, so here you have the global overview of what is virtual polymer. So it's made with four components to manage the database, to solve the analytical equation, to solve the mechanistic equation system, and finally to post-treat if you need to post-treat some output data from your mechanistic equations. I'd like to do an analogy to explain maybe better the virtual polymer tool. In fact, you have elementary equations, so it's a sort of piece of Lego. You have a lot of equations, so a lot of pieces of Lego, and you assemble this elementary equation to have your model. So you try to create a role. If you want, you can store your model in our model database, and you could also, in another part, do your prediction. So here for a nuclear power plant, of course. But this concept is also adaptable to other applications as aeronautic application, but also for train electrical cables, for example. So it was just another overview of virtual polymer. So now let's talk about study cases. So here I will just show you only simulation, so no experimental data, so keep that in mind. And I will try to start these study cases with an example to explain why it is important to take into account the thickness. I took an example, so not XLPE, but EPDM, so a pure matrix with no antioxidants in our modelization. And it was a kinetic model developed by different PhD theses done in ENSAM and with EDF. So I took three boundary conditions. The first one, a thin film, so here, I integrate diffusion, but you could consider, you will see, diffusion is negligible. Then I will add a plate, so 1 millimeter plate, so diffusion for both surfaces, and lastly, a plate, but with only oxygen for the outer surface, and no oxygen in inner surface. if you compare the two first cases, so the first one is the thin plate, and the second one is the plate of 1 millimeter. So the simulation is done at 130 degrees. Here I will have a look on the carbonyl products. So it's an oxidation marker, quite classical in polymer aging, in fact. So you have the evolution of carbonyl product as function of time. So here you have the node zero, so for example, inner surface, and the node one, outer surface. And you could see whatever the chemical species, so here the carbonyl product related to oxidation rate, with or without oxygen diffusion, we observe similar trends. So that means diffusion is negligible for thin films, in fact. So it's quite consistent, but it's a good news. We have a good simulation, in fact. The second case is the plate of 1 millimeter. So here the dotted line is the plate. So you have the node zero, and this node is really close to the it's close to the skin. So it's the skin, and it's really similar to thin films, in fact. So that means thin film is similar to the skin of the plate. And if you look at the node 4, so it's the core of the plate, you could see the oxidation rate is lower. So it's really consistent. That means diffusion for 1 millimeter plate needs to take into account, in fact. Now, if you have the same thickness, but not exactly the same boundary conditions, so at the left side, you have the oxygen for both surfaces, and at the right side, you have oxygen only for the right surface, so what I call outer surface. So here, you also look at the carbonyl concentration, but as function of thickness for different aging states. And here, whatever the chemical space is related to oxidation rate, so firstly, you have an homogeneous gradient, so it appears really fastly, in fact, so between 20 hours, between 0 and 20 hours. And after that, you could observe an heterogeneous gradient. So the oxidation rate is more important close to the skin. So it's a good news. We can simulate a plate with oxygen for both surfaces. Now, if we want to do another simulation with asymmetric boundary conditions, so only oxygen for the outer surface, you could observe we have heterogeneous gradients also. So no or little oxidation for the surface without a direct contact with oxygen. So at the left side. And we have a gradual increase in the oxidation gradient over time, so from the right of the sample in contact with oxygen to the core. So it's also a good news. We can simulate gradients, asymmetric gradients with virtual polymer. And this case is really important because it's quite close to boundary condition observed on real cable, in fact. So another study cases, why we need to take into account also diffusion and evaporation processes during our polymer aging. So here I took an example for PVC with phthalate plasticizer. So it was also kinetic model developed in a PhD thesis done with Enzam, so Ines M. Kasher. And here I will take two different kind of boundary conditions. So the first one, evaporation is a diffusion is negligible in comparison to evaporation, and the second one is evaporation is negligible in comparison to diffusion. So you have both, boundary conditions integrated in the simulation. Here you will have a look on the evolution of concentration of plasticizer, assumption of thickness, so for different aging states in 3.2 millimeter plates. So you could see you have a loss of plasticizer only close to the skin, so for the 200 micrometers close to the skin. And now if you add, in fact, a diffusion coefficient, you could see a gradual gradient along the thickness. So that means, of course, you have evaporation just to the skin, and after that you have diffusion and loss of plasticizer in the thickness. So that's why when you work on thick plates, so here thick plate, only here 3 millimeters of thickness, but it's really close to what we have on the electrical cables, it's important to take all the boundary conditions into account, so diffusion and evaporation. So now move on the team cable study case. So I would say it's not so easy sometimes to establish a multi-scale relationship. So here in our team cable project, we could study a different complexity of formulation, because we really want to understand how we can model properly the polymer aging. We define kinetic models. So as Xavier shown, so here it was an analytical model. We identify a set of parameters for each equation. We established a structure properties relationship. So here it's an example of carboline index and permittivity. So I don't know if it will be shown by Simone, but we'll see. And we define also some end-of-life criteria. So for example, a loss of antioxidants, a carbonyl content criterion reached, but it could be also hydroperoxide, because Xavier just said before, and a permittivity critical value reached also. And we have the whole chain, so we could set up some input data to do the simulation with virtual polymer, and according to our kinetic model and our multiscale relationship, we can create a sort of abacus to obtain residual duration life. So to conclude and to let the talk to Sasha, we have some specification in important specification in virtual polymer to have a generic tool and deep tactical, and to have a good quality in our code, in fact. But we need some input data, of course, so the kinetic model, the structure properties relationship, and of course define end of life criterion. And I would like to add again, but it's not so easy to add all boundary conditions in addition to our kinetic model, and in addition to the relationship between the molecular scale and the microstructure scale. So, for example, here I just today showed the diffusion of oxygen in our thickness, but of course we need to add the diffusion of antioxidant and to have the reservoir effect. So many thanks for your attention, and I would like to thank you, my colleague Charles Toumon, so a simulation expert, but also Romain Morin, which gave the birth of virtual polymer few time ago, and many some also to Elsam, of course, because all this work will not be possible with this kind of collaboration, because all this kinetic model should be done with them. Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Morgan. So is there any question for this part of the presentation? Otherwise, we can go on with Framatome's part that will focus mainly on the software.
Conci, yes, yeah.
On the Conci software.
I was wishing that this this modeling has been done like on types, right?
For Team Cable project?
Yes.
Yes.
So, I would say that there might be an influence on the way the tapes were produced compared to cables. There was some differences in the results between cables and tapes because of the way they were produced, and as well because maybe of the copper conductor inside. So maybe it would be a good thing to implement cable samples.
Yes, so the idea is to first to know the differences between the chemistry and the microstructure between tapes and cables, and if it is important in the modeling, in fact. So that's why most of the time we started with the tapes or thin films, and after that we try to extrapolate cables. And that's why I just introduced, it's only simulation, but I think the most important part will be the comparison with real cable. But yes, that's the next job.
So that's a suggestion for the next project, maybe.
Yeah, exactly.
One or two, maybe.
Yeah.